Hey everyone, welcome back to NoBullBiz TV. It's so great to be back. I'm excited about the show today. It's now been 2 weeks since we've been back, but we've been working on something extremely special for you guys, and I think that you guys are really, really gonna like it. But before I introduce our next feature, I wanted to give you guys a referral. I believe we missed doing this on the last show, and I want to give a shout out to Dean Graziosi about this book, Millionaire Success Habits.
I think, especially online right now with social media, there's the grit. You know, grit is a big word. Hustler, big word. There's so many people that have grit, and there's so many people that hustle, but they're not working hard and hustling in the right way.
I love this book. I got this book last year, read through it quickly, and really, really, really enjoyed it. One of my favorite takeaways from this book, he's having a conversation with someone, and the question was, you know, what is your biggest weakness and what is your biggest strength? And Dean says, well, my biggest weakness is that I trust too easily, and because of that, I have been taken advantage of several times. I have to learn to be more businesslike and be more shrewd. Now, I don't know if there's times when you're reading a book where things kind of stick out a little bit more of a highlighted way for you because of who you are and what you've experienced in your life. But as I was reading through the book, and I've got so many great takeaways in that book, but this one particular area, I know myself, I've struggled in business, not being shrewd enough, and really just being taken advantage of too much because having a big heart and wanting to help and wanting to do great things for people. So you have to have that shrewdness in business, and Dean really gives us some awesome advice in that. So once again, Millionaire Success Habits, and you can actually get this book online too if you Google it. Dean's got some really cool stuff that he does online, and so he'll have some promotions running, and sometimes he'll even give the book away for free. You just have to pay the shipping. So check it out. Go ahead and search him. We'll put his name up on the screen, and if we find a link, we'll actually include the link there for you guys so you can track the book down. So what we're going to do now is we're going to move right into our feature for this week. And it's with a very, very special person that I had the privilege of meeting earlier this year. And it's Gracie Gold from Team USA. Gracie Gold is a Team USA figure skater. She's making her run right now for Beijing. And we are gonna be one of her biggest fans. I can assure you that. So just to give you a little bit of a background on Gracie Gold and some of her amazing accomplishments, she's a 2014 Olympic team bronze medalist. So they won that medal when they were over in Sochi. And she's also a 2 times national champion, a 6 times national medalist, and a 4 times world team member. And Gracie is just so passionate about life and really taking advantage of the opportunity to go after success. And we have a very real, a very open conversation about some of her highlights, you know, in her career, specifically going to the Olympics in 2014, but also some of those really dark chapters in her life where she struggled with depression and anxiety. And Gracie was so kind and so brave to really open up and share some of those details with you guys. So I can't wait to get into it. I can't wait for you guys to experience this interview. It was an awesome one. And Gracie, we thank you so much for being with us. So here we go. Let's get right into the feature and introduce you to Gracie Gold.
I may not look very tough, but I can accelerate faster than the guys on the racetrack. Take harder impacts than a rider being thrown from a bull. And handle more G-force than a fighter pilot. But why just be extreme when you can be extremely graceful? I'm Gracie Gold, and this is my everywhere.
Visa, everywhere you want to be.
Guys, welcome to NoBullBiz TV again. I'm so excited today because we have the one and only Gracie Gold from Team USA here today. Gracie, how the heck are you?
I'm doing really well.
Awesome, awesome. Well, for some of you who may not know,
who Gracie Gold is, which I find that very hard to believe. Gracie Gold is a pro figure skater. So she is actually a 2014 Olympic team bronze medalist, 2 times national champion, 6 times national medalist, and 4 times world team member. So Gracie, I am very honored to have you here on the show today. So welcome to NoBullBiz TV.
Thank you. It's going to be fun.
It's going to be great. It's going to be great. So I guess before we get into just some Q&A, I guess I'm just going to tell everybody how I got to meet Gracie. So we were down in Scottsdale, Arizona, and earlier this year, and Abby, my daughter, my youngest daughter, decided that she wanted to make a run for Beijing. She'd been watching the Olympics, and she had been kind of playing around with figure skating, but never really got serious with it. And so she made this decision that she wanted to go all in. And so we had an amazing opportunity to have her work with Gracie, because Gracie happened to be down in Scottsdale hanging out at the ice den. And so there's not a lot of ice in Arizona, is there, Gracie?
No, not very much. You have a couple of rinks to pick from. A couple may be generous.
And would you agree that it's probably the most expensive ice in the world?
I will say West Coast, both in LA and in Arizona as well. That's, yeah, your figure skating is not always budget friendly wherever you are, but especially certain rinks, certain cities can be very, very pricey.
Yeah, no kidding. No kidding. Well, we learned that very quickly earlier this year. And anyways, Abby had a chance to train with you, and you were kind of in the middle of some decisions and making a bit of a jump and a transition in your life as you were deciding as well to really ramp up and make a run for Beijing coming out of what you've come out. So I won't give all those details away. We'll kind of follow the Q&A timeline here. But yeah, let's start off by, you know what, why don't you just tell everybody, how the heck did you get into the sport of figure skating? How did that happen?
Yeah, I definitely get asked that a lot. People are like, how did you, like, why figure skating? Because it's not super popular in the US. Like, it has a decent following, but it's not like other sports. So I had just moved to Springfield, Missouri. And one of my friends that I just kind of met, he had his birthday party at an ice rink. He had played hockey, et cetera, et cetera. So we go on, we have like presents and cake, whatever. So then there's a public skate after. So we rented our skates and we got on the ice. And like right away, I definitely loved it. I played a lot of sports thus far in my life. I was seven, just about to turn 8. So I'd done a lot of sports, but I never really heard of figure skating, but I didn't know anything about it. Never tried it. And I like instantly loved it. So that whole hour I was absolutely obsessed, and the rink was brand new. It was only open. It was not that long before I even showed up to public skate. So they were giving out flyers for their Learn to Skate program, like trying to get kids involved, get their rink up and running. So I took one, and my twin sister Carly was horseback riding on Saturdays, like the weekends, and I didn't have a weekend activity. So I was like, Mom, it's perfect. It's like, it's morning, but it's not early morning. Just every Saturday, like, I want to take lessons. Like, let's do that. That'll be fun. And then from there, it just snowballed real quick.
Crazy. So when you were at that birthday party, you were 7, 8 years old.
Yeah, so the birthday party, I don't even like, know the exact date I started skating, because I would have no idea what it would turn into. But I was at a birthday party sometime in the summer, and my birthday's in August. So then I remember I started taking Learn to Skate, like right, I think it was probably their fall schedule. So I think I would have turned 8 when I was doing Learn to Skate. Yeah, so around like 7, 8.
That's cool. That's, you know, what's really funny about this conversation is obviously we're Canadian. And so, you know, my girls have grown up around snow and ice their entire life, but it actually took us moving down to Scottsdale, Arizona years ago and, you know, hanging out down there. And she's like, oh, I want to skate. I want to go to the rink and skate. It's like, what? We're in Arizona. You know what I mean? So, that was just kind of funny. That's cool. That's cool. It's always good to kind of find out how people ended up, you know, getting into whatever it is. Sometimes, you know, parents are in the sport or they're pro athletes, so it's kind of a natural follow. But that's really cool how it really became your own thing.
Yeah, no, my parents were not involved at all. Like they, nothing to do with skating. So apparently, rumor has it that I'd actually stepped on ice when I was 2 because we had lived in Boston. And so apparently we had gone on like frozen ponds or lakes. I don't really remember, but apparently I hated it. So I was too cold because it was outdoors in the winter and I was 2 years old. I did not like it. So then we just never like really even talked about it again. Like we watched the Olympics, that would have been like, you know, whatever year. And I think probably 2002. I had watched it. I liked figure skating, but that didn't spark my interest until I actually did it. And even then my parents were like, yeah, sure. Like, we'll just take her to the rink on Saturdays, like whatever. That's and then wild. We're here.
That's wild. So I guess it would have been like your sister kind of followed your steps then. She got into it because you got into it or what?
Yeah. So then that December, so generally ice rinks will have like either a Christmas show or a spring show, something like that. So kind of like an annual like club thing for all the skaters. So this rink we were at had a Christmas show. And I had a trio. It was the first time that one of us had made friends that the other twin didn't have, per se. So then Carly came to watch my show. And, I mean, I wasn't, like, the star of the show or anything. That's how my parents tell the story. I mean, I was in a trio. I was skated to Jingle Bell Rock with our little costumes and everybody. I got flowers after. And Carly's like, wait, I'm taking care of horses in the middle of winter. I want to do that. So then we just got Carly involved. So then it became our little joint activity.
Oh, that's cool. That's cool. So you guys are actually like twins.
Yeah, we're twin twins.
You're twin twins. Okay, because I've never met your sister. I know that, you know, you talk about her a lot. So as twins, is it true? Because I know that there's that kind of, you know, thing out there where they say like twins, they get like separation anxiety when they're not together. So when you're not with your sister all the time or you don't see her all the time now that you're obviously an adult and she's an adult, do you guys really miss each other? I know this is, by the way, going off the Q&A, but I'm just curious.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Like, it's not – we don't have, like, the twin connection where, like, if she gets hurt, then, like, you know, I feel it exactly in my body. Like, we're not like, psychic connected. But yeah, it's definitely, that was a really difficult transition when I first moved out and away from home. It was much more difficult than I anticipated. But yeah, I probably talked to Carly. I talked to Carly like all day, every day, probably on some sort of platform, but I probably call her once a day. And then anytime I go to LA or wherever we are to meet up, I'm like, wow, I miss her so much. So that was a really, yeah, that was difficult, I would say, for both of us.
Okay, well, the next question I have here is, when did you know you would be a pro athlete? When did you know that you were going to be an Olympian? When did that hit you?
So, technically, I knew that we were, so I was going through the levels, like, as you kind of go, and you never really know, I guess, in skating. Like, some people say, oh, well, you must have known from an early age that you would just be, like, the best, you know, one of the best in the world, the best. You don't really know, especially in those middle levels where everyone's just kind of working on the jumps. Like, people progress at different rates. You know, some kids will have, they'll get stuck on one jump or like a certain element. But if they can break through that, they get the next ones all in a row, for example, which like, but I knew, so I had done well. I think I was 15 or 16 when I had my first like really big break. And then I won the US Nationals at the junior level and I skated super well. I had like these amazing jumps, everything like super great for a junior. And I'd gone to a junior, like that was when I had my first 2 international competitions. And then that's where it took on like a new meaning, is that then Team USA was sending me out to compete on behalf of them. It wasn't just like I signed up for a competition wherever and then like I competed. They were actually sending me out. And then 2-3 years later, so as figure skaters, we actually don't find out if we make the Olympic team until the national championships that year. which is like 2 weeks before the Olympics start. So yeah, so that's what's like really tricky about our sport. So I didn't know until I finished my long program at the US Championships in Boston in 2014. And I was leading going into the long program. I'd won the short, and then I skated really, really, really well. And so I just had this feeling that I won, but it wasn't. Actually, I first found out because, so Team USA sends you text messages like afterwards. So I actually got a text that said like, oh, congratulations, you qualified for the 2014 Olympics. No. That's actually how I first found out, which is like super strange, but like very with the times, I guess. So yeah, end of January is when like I officially knew I was going. But if you ask my mom, she would tell you that she always knew.
Did you screenshot that text?
Yeah, actually, no, of course I did. I think I have all of them from like my first like junior Grand Prix International, like all the way up. Even like my first world championships, you know, like first anything like that. Yeah, those are all archived, absolutely.
So what was that? What was that feeling like though? Like when you got that text, was that something that you were expecting, or were you still like, holy crap?
I was expecting that a little bit more because there's a rule that if you win the national championships on an Olympic year, like you have a ticket to the games. The rest of it is technically up to a selection committee, but like if you win, you're going. So then definitely right after I finished the program, I was like, oh, I'm in. But then when I got my scores and I was in first place, then I like definitely knew. But then as the rest of the week unfolded, it got more and more real.
Yeah, I bet. I bet.
Oh, yeah.
And just all that stuff that comes with it, hey?
Oh, absolutely.
What a feeling, Gracie. That's amazing. I guess one of the reasons why I love it so much and why I love, you know, talking to you and just this whole like Team USA and representing your country, Olympic rush, the Olympic run, you know, for me, my dream as a young athlete when I was in high school was to be a ski racer, you know, and ski racing was my sport. I'm representing my Team Canada Alpine today. But that's why I can't even imagine what the feeling was when you just knew. And then, like you said, it just became more and more real as that week went on because, you know, everything that leads up to going on that journey. So, okay. So when did you, I guess you answered that question because I said, when did you make it on the Team USA, which you just explained. But once you made it onto the team, as you said, you know, as that week started to unfold, it started to become more and more real. After you made Team USA, you're going to the Olympics. What did that journey look like?
So far, I've reached more success than I dreamed of. It's almost too amazing to even imagine. When I picture going to Sochi in the Olympics, I don't just picture my skating. I picture that moment when you're walking around by your flag and just that feeling of pure joy. I could win the US Championships as long as I go out there and I just throw down the gauntlet and I say, this is what I can do, beat it.
Like I said, the turnaround between the national championships, like aka figure skating's Olympic trials, so to speak, and then to the Olympics was super short because they try to pick because you have to get visas and stuff, especially because the Olympics were in Russia. So like they kind of pick a handful of you to do like promos and then like get the visa and like start feeling it out. But you actually, because just like any sport, you don't really know. Like it's really hard to pick, you know, like even like the top three for a second, third, let alone like a whole group of people. So then there were some surprise finishers, but yeah, so we had forms to fill out. We were getting visas and just like realizing, cause we kind of knew what was going to happen, but it's never like you want to jinx it. You know, they'd ask me like certain questions and I was like, oh, maybe if I make it, that's what I'd want to do. So that 2 weeks, because then you're also still training, right? You don't like go on vacation and celebrate. Yeah. So then you're training and then you're trying to get everything. And then you're just finally on the plane flying. You have Olympic processing to get all of your gear. It's kind of, I think that maybe because nationals was so stressful because it's 7 minutes to determine if you go to the Olympic Games or not. But I think the aftermath closer to the Olympics was almost less stressful.
And this morning at Today in the Week, we have more with Golden Girl Gracie Gold. She surprised everyone except probably herself this weekend by taking first place at Nationals. That secures her a spot on the U.S. Olympic team. We talked to Gracie a little bit earlier. She's back to skate for us. So between now and Sochi, Gracie, how many hours a day are you going to spend at the rink working out and rehearsing?
3 to 4 hours on the ice. Minimum on the ice, and then I'm going to have ballet twice a week, and you know, off ice for an hour three times a week. So I'll be keeping busy until Sochi.
Because I had already reached like my emotional capacity for stress and anxiety and like excitement in January. So I think February was almost like a breath.
I bet.
To bring it down. I mean, not much, but just like a little bit.
Just a little, hey.
Just like enough to take the edge off of like maximum stress capacity.
Wow. So obviously your first Olympics was Sochi 2014.
Yes. Right?
And so what was it like, Gracie, walking into the opening ceremonies at the Winter Olympics with your team representing Team USA?
So that was really, really wild. So you start like the march, because you have to get into the stadium, right? And that's so many athletes, because every Olympian pretty much is there for opening ceremonies. So we have all of our like designated gear on, and we just kind of start the walk, and you can kind of see the big building, because you kind of get under it and then you pop up. Like that's kind of it. And then we walked out. And when we stepped out, I don't know like the exact number of people that were in the stadium in Russia, but it was an unbelievable amount. Like just, and on the back of everyone's chair or like on the seats or something, they had these light up plastic medals. So everyone had theirs on. So that's like thousands of lights, like tens of thousands of lights. And it's so big, the roof is open. And then you kind of step out. And of course there are cameras, you know, that stuff's everywhere. So you're just, and then you're all just trying to walk in formation while filming on your phone. And like, it was unbelievable. And then to see how many Team USA athletes we actually had across all disciplines was immense. And then I found out like summer, of course, has way more. So you can't even imagine what walking in like a summer games would be like. Because I thought there was just a mass of red, white, and blue.
No kidding.
Yeah, just trying to also keep track, because we're, like, all of the athletes are friends, but your close friends would be within your discipline. So I'm trying to keep track of, like, my discipline friends, but also, like, it was unbelievable.
Wow. Something that you'll never obviously forget.
Oh, yeah, and nothing I'll probably ever experience quite like that unless I went to another Olympics. But there's certainly nothing in real life that I've experienced that is even really comparable.
That's crazy. You know, I was looking at photos last night of you at the Sochi, and you've got that, when you guys are on the podium, you're wearing that kind of silver kind of space looking jacket. That jacket's sick. Do you still have that jacket?
Oh, absolutely. So we got, Ralph Lauren, whichever, they do the opening and closing ceremony gear, and then Nike does the village wear, so to speak. So they kind of share the branding on that, I guess. So we had navy blue ones in the same style, and then it has like all these amazing details on it. Everything is like, that was designed to a T. And then if you had won a medal, those were the like really cool, almost like spaceman silver ones.
Yeah.
So then you could tell in the village like which Team USA athletes had medal, because then we started wearing ours. So like some people still wear the navy, but of course if we had won a medal, we were wearing the space one. Yeah, I absolutely still have that jacket. That's, of course.
Sick jacket. Very cool. So when you arrived at the Winter Olympics, obviously there's so much emotional stuff going on with you and you know your other athletes on your team. But for you personally, what was your biggest stress when you got to the Winter Olympics?
So for me, I would say overall the biggest stress was, so that was the first time that in figure skating we had the team events. So I was a couple years prior, they made a new event called the World Team Events to kind of practice, because we knew that in the 2014 games, it would be an Olympic event. So we had done a couple of like the World Team Trophy or whatever, to kind of practice what it would feel like. But I was really stressed about that because I got tagged to do the long program at the team event. And I had never, because in skating, you really skate for yourself. Like, yeah, you have your country and, you know, your support team and your coaches and your parents, what have you. But never had, like, my score would have affected other athletes, if that makes sense. So I was really stressed about that because I didn't want to be the one that, you know, like, botched it for the team. Not that, like, I mean, if somebody else had, I wouldn't have viewed it that way. But I was so worried that I'm like, I'm going to blow it. I'm going to blow it for Team USA, the long program, like, super stressed about that. And of course, that would be like my opening Olympic moment. Yes. So that probably weighed the most on my shoulders. But fortunately, that was right out of the gate. So we had opening ceremonies, and then there was short program, which Ashley Wagner did, and then long program, me. So once that was over, I actually felt a lot better.
Okay.
Because I did skate really well in it. So that helped me feel so much better.
I was going to ask you, when did it finally kind of calm down for you? Was it after the very first event? Like the first time getting on the ice
So after that first long program, and then we had like Team USA, the team event medal ceremony. And then we actually, the three women, Ashley, Polina, and I, we had left the village because we went to go train in Graz because there was more ice time and there weren't just cameras and reporters, a little bit quieter. So we went there for, I think, like a week and a half, which was nice. And then we came back to get ready for the singles events. That was super nice that the ladies had a huge break between the team event and the singles. So that was really a blessing because the pairs and the men, they had to do team event, singles event within, I think, almost the same week. So that's three programs at the Olympics within the same week. Like that's both physically and emotionally. I mean, I could not have imagined that. So after I kind of had that week and a half and then I came back and I was getting into the rhythm of being in the Olympic Village, I was really starting to feel better.
That's awesome. Wow. So cool. Well, I guess we're going to kind of switch gears a little bit and talk about something a little bit more serious that's been a little bit more recent with your journey. Not so exciting. But something that I think you and I kind of connected on level. Obviously, we went through totally two different type of experiences, and you know, people know, basically in the No Bull community, No Bull Biz community, what I've gone through. I've talked about it, and I've also shared those details with you. But what we want to do is we want to hear from you a little bit today, specifically about when did you first struggle with depression. I know that that's something that you and I have shared kind of, you know, privately. But you know, you're just this amazing human being, Gracie, that has got a real heart for other people who struggle in and around the same issues that you and I have struggled with. And here you are today, brave and stepping up and willing to, share a story that really for most people is very, very uncomfortable. So, you know, I guess my question is, when did you first, you know, struggle with depression, and what was your strongest trigger kind of associated with that?
So I would say like the first time I ever even really had like a touch with something like depression, because being first off like a young adult, and then, you know, in like a pro athlete world, and then something like figure skating, which is super transparent and exposing, because you know you go out there by yourself in the middle of the ice with NBC, you know, thousands of people watching you skate a performance. So I'd had like some emotional feelings like that before, such as like anxiety and, you know, like pressure and feelings of being overwhelmed. But the first time I really got into like depression type of feelings, like the darker ones, I was so right actually after the Olympics, I definitely had some post-Olympic depression, which it turns out is a super real thing that most athletes go through, because you train, you know, your whole life essentially, even if you're kind of maybe to the Olympics, maybe not the Olympics, but like that's ultimately the dream, you know, your whole life. And then you have 7 minutes for other sports, you know, it can be like 30 seconds. Other sports, you know, you have longer to go, but and then you hit the Olympics and it goes well or doesn't go as well. And then after, it's like, now what? That was, so then other people were like, oh, well, we have, you know, something called Champs Camp coming up. I remember my coach was like, oh, or like a local competition because we're getting ready for the next season. And I remember feeling really like, you know, it's, you know, I just had, you know, this whole rise and now I'm like, I have to gear up to perform like the same way for a local competition or, you know, then even that like Grand Prix events or things like that felt kind of less than. So I definitely, I would say that after the Olympics, that the rest of that spring and then even a little bit into the summer were hard for me to bounce back, I guess, in a way, because it kind of just felt, everything felt less than because I was on such a high for so long. So that was the first time. And then just a little bit of time and like my family was super supportive getting back into it. You know, I found the rhythm for the next like two and a half years. And then everything had been going really well. And then, so I started really having struggles after the 2016 World Championships. I'd been having like, there was a lot of stuff in like my like personal family life that was really chaotic. And then I had skating though. Right. So like I was still able to manage well, but then I use the word bomb, but like I came in fourth at the World Championships, which for me, cause I was thinking first place, like first place or everything else, didn't want it. So then I came in fourth and I fell in the long program and then it didn't help that like the rest of my life was also on fire and then skating. And so I really started to go down pretty quickly. And I ended up last about a year ago, actually, maybe like 12, 14 months, I actually ended up in treatment, as you know, because I was absolutely like so clinically depressed. And that was definitely a really big struggle for me. And I look back on it, not sad because there was like amazing personal growth, but it really opened my eyes to like the struggles of mental health and how there still really is that stigma around it. But yeah, like it's really uncomfortable for a lot of people to talk about. I remember when I was in treatment and like I've seen like quotes like this around, but like if I had a broken leg, you know, they wouldn't let me skate on a broken leg. And everyone, you know, I would, you know, if I had gone skating on a broken leg, they'd be like, oh my God, you have to rest. You know, and I wouldn't think of myself as a bad athlete. You know, I would have thought of myself as like something in my body's not working. But then the same thing happened in my head. And, you know, I didn't give myself time to like fix it. Like I didn't give myself any time after that World Championships to process and be easy on myself. You know, instead I just like kept running headfirst into the same wall until I literally had to go into treatment for like a mental health crisis is what it really spiraled into.
Wow. That's an incredible way of explaining it. Because when we go through it, the initial reaction is to ignore it. And if we were doing that with like a broken leg or a broken arm, it'd be just a matter of time and then we're in big trouble, right?
Oh, absolutely.
And I think that's what a lot of us do, Gracie. I think a lot of us ignore kind of the initial, you know, part of maybe what we're struggling with in and around depression. But then, you know, we keep using that leg, we keep using that arm, and then eventually you can't move.
Yeah, you just really reach that breaking point where I'm not sure if this statistic is still true, but last time I checked it was, but I think in especially young adults, the first leading cause of death would be accidents, either like car or whatever. And then the second leading cause of death is suicide, which, you know, indicates to me it's not like a mental health problem, but really more of a crisis. And really going into treatment and like meeting, I went to like a young adult kind of program. And even just talking with other people that, you know, have maybe reached out to me, I realized that it can be a huge problem that completely derails or ends lives. And so the broken, wherever like I read or someone told me that in treatment, obviously resonated with me as an athlete, and I'm sure you kind of, but like if I, yeah, you know, if I hurt my ankle or like when I broke my foot, I've had a couple of injuries in my career. I was never like, oh my God, Gracie, you suck. You know, you're the world's worst athlete. You let everyone down. No, like my body needs a break. But when my head wasn't going well, and I think like with everyone, there are signs that we definitely ignore for whatever reason. But I definitely know, like, you know, some of mine that when they, I mean, hindsight's 20/20. So when I look back, I'm like, ooh, that was definitely a sign. That was a sign. And I just kept saying, no, it's fine. Mm-hmm. Fine was like my favorite word. It's fine.
It's fine.
Everything's fine, even though it was not.
Yeah, part of living in that plastic fake world that we live in, for sure. So I guess, when did you feel that you could reach for help? I know that a lot of people that struggle with anxiety, depression, thoughts of suicide, you know, it's very real to them. But they don't feel safe enough to even just reach out to family members, right? Because like you said, there's this stigma in and around mental health. And we know it's a lot bigger of a problem than everybody wants to admit. I mean, I think a lot of people, if not most people in the world, struggle at some level anyways with anxiety and depression, depending on what they do with their, you know, with their life. But when did you get to a point where you felt safe enough? Was there that special person? Was like, what was it that actually gave you the courage to be able to say, you know what? Yeah. My mind, my head is broken and I need help.
So I guess, yeah, like most people, cause they don't feel safe reaching out. That's a kind of a common thread, or they didn't feel comfortable. So then I think back and I'm like, why don't we feel comfortable? Because, and I, for me, I felt like I was going to be judged or have like my reality denied. Mm-hmm. That, well, you're Gracie Gold. Like, what do you have to be depressed about? You know, like you have, you know, look at your life, look at all these things. How could you be depressed? And I've actually had like people that like semi close to me, like say that before. And they said, no, like that's like, you might feel down, but being depressed is when you're like homeless on the street and you know, you have nothing to live for. Like that's depression. And I said, well, yeah, that might be a form of depression, but I have a feeling that other people might, because it was denied. It was like, what you're feeling isn't really real. Even though in my head, I'm like, to me though, it's so very real, which is kind of what matters. If in someone's reality, they feel like they have so much anxiety or stress, or I mean, I know people like OCD, ADHD, any kind of thing like that, where it's, you feel that in your life, it's out of hands, then it's a problem to you. And like, that should be validated. And I feel like a lot of times it's not. So for me, I realized that I was at an impasse where, so I was struggling because I had a lot of like suicidal ideation is kind of what they call it, but I didn't really want to die. But the way that I was living, I could not go on living like that. So I was kind of stuck in this balance of like, something so clearly has to change, because I was just kind of existing and suffering. And I knew that if some of the pain went away, then I wouldn't want to die. Like I didn't want, for me, but like other people might feel that way. But I was kind of stuck in this limbo that was really difficult. And I was really stuck in there for quite a while, where if somebody had asked me like, no, I don't have a plan. Like I don't want to die, but like, I can't keep doing this. Like my life, I'm suffering. So I think it was, so I was actually at a Team USA camp where that was really the final breaking point is, I felt that there were one or two people that said some things that were very kind of insensitive. But looking back though, like they just didn't know what was going on. So for them, it was just like an athlete that didn't really show up to play, was like out of shape, looked kind of like they didn't care, you know, like looking back on it. But at the time I thought like my existence is a cry for help. Like, how can you not see that we have a code red emergency here? So something that I perceived as insensitive, and I like kind of lashed out at them, which was really rare for me. And especially kind of like my MO in skating was like very plastic Barbie, prim and proper. So for me to tell important people at my federation off, including some profanity, was like very uncharacteristic of me. Yeah, like it's referred to now as the incident. But then after that had played out, I just showed up to, I had like a cooking class or something. And one of my close friends, one of the Team USA members, she asked like a certain question and I absolutely told her the most honest answer, like something about my life. And she just stopped still. She said, "What?" I said, "Oh yeah." And then it just like kept going. I just kept like telling her everything from like start to finish about how my life was just a mess. And she like didn't even know what to say, but she just sprung into action. And she and another member were really some of the fundamental people in getting me the help that I needed. But now I guess looking back, I just wonder if certain things that could be in place to where, you know, someone wouldn't have to get to where I was living and feeling in that critical point before they get help.
Well, I mean, I remember the one evening that we were driving in my Porsche Cayenne,
and yeah,
Abby and I were in the car, and you know, you just started sharing, you started opening up with us, and you were going into a lot of detail about life and just, you know, your very personal and private journey of life and a lot of the stuff that had been happening in your life that, as you describe, is chaotic. And I was just like, because honestly, when I met you, Gracie, I had this totally different expectation of who you were going to be, right? Because I knew you as whoever it was that appeared on TV screens, right? And so you just have this idea of you know, who this person is. And then I meet you and I find out how real you are and how transparent you are and how strong you are. And it's funny because we got into a conversation a couple months ago with, you know, other people that have really struggled with, you know, thoughts of suicide to the point of really kind of making the decision that today is the day I'm going to take my life. And it's funny because a lot of people out there would say, you know, people who kill themselves are not strong, they're weak. However, it's completely the opposite. I'm not strong enough to kill myself. I know that because I went to that point, crazy. You know what I'm saying? And it's crazy to think that way, but you got to think about how incredibly strong you have to be to actually get to a point where you say, okay, I'm done. I'm out. I do not see a light at the end of the tunnel. And I think a lot of times it happens to people that have reached a very high level of success, whatever that is, going to the Olympics, medaling, you know, starting a company, becoming a multimillionaire, maybe a billionaire. But once you get to a certain level, you kind of get to a point where you go, well, what's next? Is there a next? You know what I'm saying? So here you are today. You know, we're sitting here. It's you know, almost the end of September 2018. You've made a decision now to make a run for Beijing 2022. How do you go from, you know, in treatment, struggling with depression, getting out of treatment, kind of moving slowly back into the sport, and then one day looking in the mirror and saying, all right, I'm going, I'm getting it, I'm going after Beijing? How the heck does that happen?
That's a great question. So like I said, when I was at that impasse where, like, you know, I didn't want to die, but like I couldn't go on the way that I was exactly. Kind of fluctuating there. I guess like skating was the same. Like I didn't want to not skate, but the way that my life was going, I couldn't keep trying to skate and train, you know, like in that way. So what I ended up doing was just kind of putting the pause button. And then I kind of in October is when I got out of treatment, and I was like, there's no way that anyone would have enough time to go from October to January at the national championships, which would have potentially qualified me for 2018. I was like, okay, even like I'm very ambitious, but that's going to send me like right down the rabbit hole. So I was like, okay, so we're just going to take a break. And then I was kind of living for the first time like a normal life, if that makes sense. So I had like skating's not 9 to 5, it's like way earlier, but I kind of was coaching with this regular life. I had roommates, you know, I had just regular people, bills and problems and things like that. And I liked it for a little bit. And then I went to see, and then I just wasn't really thinking about skating at all. Cause then I was trying to think, what am I going to do now moving forward? Like thinking about college and careers and, you know, what have you. Mm-hmm. But then I went to watch the Nationals in January. US figure skating was like, hey, why don't you just come watch? Like it's the, essentially the Olympic trials for 2018. And it was in California. Carly was going because she does some photography. So I said, oh, yeah, great. Let's make a trip. So we go. And then I just kind of watched the, like, thing play out again that I had lived before. And I was just watching skating and, like, kind of being back in the environment. I forgot how many great things that there are. And I think I just as a lot of elite skaters that I've talked to, a lot of us just get burned out and, like, you know, bitter and just kind of, we really focus on the negatives. And then I realized like how many great things there are about skating and, you know, going through the international circuit, the competition, stuff like that. So I went and then I met my coach that I'm, who's coaching me now there. And like, we hit it off and I just started, then like, it just, it kind of planted that seed in my brain. So then I kept, it was about April when I like really made the decision to go for it. But I just kept thinking about how I didn't really have that time where I'm like, this is going to be my last season competing. You know, it's going to be great. This is going to be my final hurrah. You know, it's time for me to move on. You know, circumstances had really led me to ending my career. Not against my will, because I knew I had to stop, but I wasn't ready yet. So then I decided, I was like, you know what, let's go back and see. Maybe it's as horrible as like I used to think it was and like stressful and but I was like, but I'm like, it's part of my identity. It's like, I'm a skater. I'm a figure skater. I'm an athlete. Like, this is what I do. And, you know, that was kind of so young for someone to retire, especially when they just retired because of like a mental health crisis, I guess, like, you know, like, so I fixed myself in a way, you know, it's kind of a daily journey, but put myself back together, getting back into skating. And so then we would have 4 years for the next Olympics, which was more like in my head, like my ideal retirement is I would have had this many years and like go out in Beijing. So it's not, there are many more bumps in the road than I like first envisioned, but I'm looking forward to like really enjoying the process again.
Yeah, you definitely can't eat as many cronuts at this point.
No, I definitely, one part of retirement, because I also had gone in for like disordered eating, I did enjoy not having to worry about that at all. Because I was so, as a skater, like I'd gotten so in my head about, you know, like dieting and food and where that was another aspect that just drove me nuts. Yeah. So that was kind of something nice that in retirement, I just didn't have to worry. It was all about like convenience and like delicious food. And now that I like kind of did get like a lot of treatment and help with that, I can still enjoy like a cronut on my like journey back into skating. I just can't eat like 12 anymore, which is probably good for like my heart anyway, but...
Yeah, I agree. I totally agree. Well, that's crazy because I know like basically in March when we connected in Scottsdale, that's really, you were really at that pivoting point of, okay, I think I'm going to go back. I don't really know what this looks like, but I've got an opportunity now and I want to do this. And so you made that decision and here you are, you went from Scottsdale. Now you're out in Delaware, right? Delaware is kind of the area, Philly. And ice is probably a little bit cheaper out there, I would think.
Definitely a cheaper area to live in than like North Scottsdale or like LA where I was living before. But figure skating will always be a very expensive sport. Wherever you are, it's just always pricey.
Yeah, totally. So I guess, you know, it's really important that we're having this conversation and kind of, you know, moving out of, you know, the depression talk and stuff like that. And I know that you're in a very different season, a very different chapter of your life right now, but how important, and this is really why I wanted to have this conversation with you today, because one of the biggest things that we're doing in our business community, NoBullBiz, is we're creating a community where people can plug in and really equip themselves with whatever it is that they need to start that company, go to the next level, maybe in their profession, in their sport. But we know right now, because we've been talking about mental health specifically, how important mindset is specifically in what you want to do in your life. Either you're going to be on autopilot, you know, you're going to be a human being that just wakes up in the morning and, like, as you said, kind of exists and just kind of shows up and is on autopilot and just kind of drifting along, or you take control of your mind and you work as a very focused and a very disciplined individual. So how important is your mindset and your mindset training as a professional athlete?
I mean, it really is of the utmost importance in skating and in regular life, office, whatever you want to do. Because if our, like, especially in skating or in any sport, like, your body is kind of your tool, but your mind controls your body. So if your mind isn't working, you know, how are you expecting things to work out, especially like a super specific, complicated sport like skating? You know, you can't just, like, throw some stuff together and, like, jump into the air. Like, everything, you know, the precision of skating is really what makes it so difficult. Yeah, and, like, everyone will have, like, some autopilot days, but it's super difficult because sometimes when you start to get onto autopilot days, it's really hard to go back to those days where you're, like, awake and aware. Mm-hmm. So, especially...
Totally.
It just, it's super, super important. And having a positive mindset, you know, it's super easier. It's so much easier to say than, like, do. But I guess I started, when I was coming back into skating, I was always kind of thinking, I was like, okay, let's just pick a goal for today that is very, very attainable. And let's look at it from that point of view. So sometimes even when I was, like, working on jumps or, like, my program and, like, quality, I didn't like what I was doing. I was at least like, okay, well, I'm still working out. Like, this is still a physical exercise. You know, repetitions are helping me. Let's just focus on that. Especially when I was, like, really trying to get back into shape. I'm like, doing anything is better than nothing. So I really had to just change my mindset and think, like, on any of the positive things I could find. Because it's so easy to get stuck in the negative. Especially in a sport where if you're racing a clock or... you know, you're competing against other people or judges or yourself. It's so easy because it's like, it's never good enough, yeah. Which is what makes athletes, like the elite ones, super good, is that it's never enough. It's never good enough, you know, whatever. But if you get too trapped in that world, you know, then it's like everything sucks. So I really have to find, like, every day I try to find a goal I can do. I set aside just even like a little bit of time for myself. Like for me in the morning is always a super... like, that's me time. So I have, like, my notebook. I'm a big notebook person. Chart down, like, everything that, you know, I need to do and want to do. My schedule, I look it over. I have my coffee. You know, just kind of sit in my apartment in silence and, like, really get ready for the day. You know, write down a goal for the day, things like that. Because without that, I would just, the whole day and, like, the whole week, it can slip away from me really easily, especially when people are busy. So I think mindset's really everything. And also being aware, I think maybe the hardest part is when you have to be aware to realize that you're not in a good mindset. Because I've had a couple of days where, like, skating just didn't go well for, like, 3 days in a row. I was just getting more and more and more frustrated. And then I looked back and I was like, okay, well, what happened on those 3 days, like, besides skating? Like, was something else off? Was this wrong? Like... you know, did my day just start off, you know, not well, and I let it snowball, and trying to catch that kind of negative snowball effect as early as possible to get back on the right track. And that's difficult because it looks different for everyone. You know, like, there's not a recipe for being an Olympian, and then there's not a recipe for having, like, great mental health. It's super different for everyone. There are baselines, but it's going to look different for every single person.
Totally. So would you agree that, you know, like, you didn't just go into treatment and then get better, like, you know, you pop some magic pill and you're ready to go, you're all fixed. But do you really agree with me that, you know, having a very focused, disciplined, and committed life and wanting to perform at a high level requires daily mindset management?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Like treatment was, so it's kind of like if you like bring, so like if you go into treatment and you like say like, these are all the things that are wrong. If you bring them your life and you're like, oh, it kind of sucks. Like all of these things are wrong. Like they're not going to glue and tape it back together for you. Like they can help give you the glue and the tape, you know, and everything else that you need. But like, you have to do it yourself. If there was like a magic pill for success, everybody would already have been taking it. Like we would already be on the market in like different flavors and like everybody would love it. Mm-hmm. It's not like even when I went into treatment, I didn't even want to take like any antidepressants or anti-anxiety or things like that. It's really against it because I was like, well, I just have to change my behavior and like how I view the world. So yeah. And that's like, I tell a lot of people when they say, you know, like what's one thing that you would tell kids that want to be like an Olympic figure skater or maybe an Olympian in general. And depending on like the platform, like if I'm actually talking to kids, you know, I usually would tell them like, make sure to have fun with it, you know, enjoy the process. But like on another side, like really, really know what you're getting into. Like you have to possess, discipline is a huge one. You know, mind over matter and all of these different things. It's going to be like being successful is time consuming. Like it is, like you can't just go off and do all these things. Like you have to prioritize your life, and people that don't want to do that, you know, maybe aren't always as successful. But I find that like the kids that really do well in skating are the ones that are goal oriented, they're disciplined, and they can kind of, they're the ones that enjoy it. Like they enjoy ice skating, but they also enjoy the process of training and that day-to-day grinds. Because if you don't like the day-to-day grinds or you're not committed enough to go through it, like you're not going to get anywhere. You don't just wake up and you're like, oh, I'm at the Olympics. Like, oh, I have a $1 million company. Like,
exactly.
If it was that easy, we all would.
Oh, isn't that the truth? You know, it's funny because we actually experienced this year with Abby. And so, you know, Abby met you and I told you and I told the other coaches that she was working with, you know, turn up the heat, right? I want her to feel what it's like to really, you know, be trained at a level that's going to not guarantee you that you're going to even get there, but at least you're going to understand what it's going to actually really take to get down that road. Right. And you have to fall in love with the pain. It's like cycling. I love cycling, but you have to fall in love with the burn of cycling, the burn of your legs. Right. And until you can actually turn that feeling into like, oh, that's cool, because there's actually something happening, right? We're actually making progress here. Until you actually get to that point mentally, you know, you get to that burn stage and you're like, oh, that kind of hurts. I think I'm, you know, I'd like to just stop right now. But you don't realize that that's actually the breakthrough, right?
Yeah.
So I love having this conversation with you because I know that you know that, you know, it's not just showing up, but there is literally systemization that has to be in place in order for you to get the result, go win the championship, make the team, do all these things that you have to do. Just because you went to the Olympics before doesn't guarantee you a spot for 2022.
Absolutely not. Like and that's the same for anything. Like just because you made like one like super great business does not guarantee that like every other idea you have like is just going to prosper. Like,
right.
You know, everything. And like showing up is always the first step. So like I always applaud people for showing up, you know, like ready to work. Mm-hmm. But then what's the next step after that? Like, yes, that's important. But like I tell parents all the time, like the beauty of putting your kids in athletics and sports is not how many medals they're going to get, if they're going to get any fame, how much money they could make. It's all about the things that it gives your child. So like, skating wasn't really like a team sport, but on team sports, how to work well with others, you know, how to like, you know, prioritize things, the discipline, definitely in skating, like respect, you know, playing well with others, that kind of thing. responsibility, time management is a big one that, you know, it's all of those things that it can give you, which is like why, you know, you should put your kid in skating, soccer, football, hockey, whatever. It has almost nothing to do with Olympic medals. Like that comes later. And then to get there, you know, requires like another level. But even just starting on like being just good or like why you should show up for things is all of the things it can give you. Falling in love with the process. You know, they always say it's not the destination, it's the journey. Yeah. But like, it's true. Like it, that's the part. Cause that's like, I spend 99.9% of my time training, cold, too hot, uncomfortable. Because when we go to compete, it's only 7 minutes. So if you weigh how many hours a day I skate, how many days per week, how many weeks in my whole life versus how many 7 minutes I've done.
Yeah.
Like 99% of it is falling, you know, achy, tired, painful. I'm either too cold or I'm too hot. Like I'm stressed out, but like it builds character. Work ethic, you know, all things that unsuccessful people, like that successful people, like they all have.
It's true. No, you're right. I mean, you think about how much better this world would be if everybody did personal development, if everybody did mindset training, if everybody built character, right? So Gracie, this is amazing. I mean, we're getting so much information here. I hope people are taking notes. The last thing, and I know this didn't make the you know, the Q&A list, but you know, you've done a good job of just kind of covering some of the questions all in the same responses. But one of the things I've noticed, and we were talking about just the other day about rituals and how, you know, professionals, people, titans, people at the highest levels of life have rituals. And I've been working on a set of my rituals this year as I've been, you know, rebuilding my life and launching new companies and inventing new products and working with, you know, new executive teams. And so one of the things that I've really paid close attention to is that people that are very successful protect their intimate time, right? And they have rituals and they have a certain way that they do things, whether that's in the morning, at nighttime, a combination of both. I know for me that I have to start my day with a very focused module of time being about 2.5 to 3 hours. And some people go, that's crazy, Jeremy. You're going to spend 2.5 to 3 hours on meditation, reading, you know, training, whatever you're doing in order just to get ready for the day. That's I can't do that, but you have to, if you want to perform at the highest levels, you have to develop rituals. So would you be willing to give us a little bit of a peek into what is kind of the ritual life or your favorite rituals for Gracie Gold as a professional athlete?
I mean, different points in my life, I've had different like rituals, so to speak, but there are always like some common themes. I guess, and like people, like just because you spend like, you know, 2 to 3 hours, you know, in the morning, like it might look different, like for everyone. Like some people may only need, you know, an hour. Yes. And it maybe could be in the morning, you know, in the middle of the day to check in, at night, like doing whatever. But, you know, like the theme being that like you have to find like your thing that helps you not only feel the best, but is like, you know, gets you centered and grounded and like to live your best productive life, which in certain fields is like really key. I would say almost all of them. For me, like I said, in the morning, like I always have to have like my list. I always have like 2 to 3 notebooks in whatever bag I'm carrying. Because I do best when I write everything down, because I know that I can't keep everything in my head and it feels better to put it down. So like, that's like always a huge one for me. It could be like super simple things, but like do laundry. Okay. I know that I need to do laundry, but sometimes getting it out of my head is like the best way. And in the morning, and then a lot of times, so like when I get to the rink, like I pretty much warm up the same way every day. I have like my like key exercises and warm-ups that I like and that they make me feel the best. Same when I get on the ice. Like there are certain, you know, warm-up exercises and moves that like I need to do to like set myself up to skate on the best session. you know, there's, and for me, like when I was getting here and like a lot of people were asking me, like my coaches, well, what kind of schedule do you want? Like, what's your normal setup? And I said, honestly, guys, it can kind of be whatever, you know, like the ice time, whatever, but it just needs to be the same. Because for me, that's the key, is whatever I do, it, like repeating it day after day after day is the same. So I said, I could have your lesson at like 11 or 12 or 1 or 2, but I need it to be identical every single day. Yeah. That's what needs to go, like check, 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 check. So that for me is like super important. And a lot of times when I first get to the rink in the morning, I always get a coffee on my way to the rink. And even just sitting in my car, you know, the parking lot's pretty empty at that time. Just sitting in my car, like whatever music I have on, just kind of like in my head, just like, you know, getting up for the day or like reading like whatever news is on my phone or like checking in with any of the like positive affirmation apps that I have, stuff like that. So I have like a good 15-minute chunk in the morning where I just like really sit in my car and like just like kind of zone in before I get ready, you know, to turn the car off and go into the rink.
So what's your favorite source of positivity? You mentioned a positive, you know, kind of application that gives you positive content. Is it reading a book? Is it an app? What's one thing that you could tell us that you would recommend somebody if they're looking for a little bit more positivity in their life?
So when I first started like looking up like positive things, and sometimes this is like super like basic white girl, but honestly, Pinterest, no, like hear me out. Like I'm not here pinning out like, you know, like decorations and like holiday theme parties and like, you know, like my future wedding, like, you know, like my main use for it is because it's such like kind of a big platform and it is very like female friendly, heavily female users, I would say. I don't know any dudes that have a Pinterest, quite frankly.
I do.
You do? Okay. So I at least know one. So sometimes if I'm just looking like mostly now I've like groomed it. So like my whole feed is like various like inspirational and they're not even like all self-help affirmations. Like, you know, like today is going to be a good day. Sometimes they're just like inspirational quotes, motivational quotes, because there's just so much on Pinterest. Mm-hmm. Like you could pin for like the rest of your life and not see all the pins that I'm sure exist. And it's also just so easy because, like, I just know how to work it. And they're, like, different. I've tried some different, like, meditation apps I've played around with. And I like them. They're cool. But for me, it's more about, like, I'm really, like, visual. So for me, anything with, like, words, So that's kind of, I would say, like, my outlet. I have a plethora of, like, inspirational kitchen magnets, like – for me, those kind of quotes.
We need to feel very privileged right now because Gracie's letting us take a look at her kitchen of all places today. And she's a fan of the Today Show. That one's standing out like really bright.
That one? Yeah. Yeah, we have a couple of really good ones. Some weird ones.
What's that one, leap? I see the word leap.
Yeah, this one, leap and the net will appear. I do live my life that way. Like a lot of people were like, oh my God, like Delaware, Pennsylvania, like, do you know anyone there? Have you been to that ring? I was like, I'm going to leap and the net will appear.
Wow. Gracie, that's sick. I love that. That's a good one.
Yeah. Yeah, let's see. We have, you know, be mindful even if your mind is full.
That's good too. I like that.
Yeah, I like that one a lot. I tell this to like a lot of my students, like life begins at the end of your comfort zone. Which is really important because for me, I do tend to be a homebody, and because I like my sometimes like my daily rituals, so much that sometimes I do even remind myself like to get out of my comfort zone. So like add more like new different things to the warm up, even though it's the same time. You know, like try reading, you know, like a different kind of book or like whatever it is, trying new things. Because growth happens like when you leave your comfort zone, which in skating, you know, you pretty much exist outside of your comfort zone. Like, especially when you're on like a really big platform, there's like NBC cameras in your face. Like, very few people are just hardwired to absolutely know how to handle that right off the bat and just manage it perfectly. Few people. So I'm definitely not one of them. Like, I had to learn how to like get out of my comfort zone, because that is where life begins.
Oh, I love it. I love it. So just to kind of bring this up, you know, into a close, and just, you know, for somebody who's watching this, you know, this conversation that we're having today, and maybe they're sitting on the fence, you know, maybe they've had a job their whole life, but, you know, they've got this dream, or maybe it's a young person that's, you know, got a dream to be an athlete, or maybe start a company. What advice would you give them today if they're just sitting on the fence and they're scared to jump, and they just don't believe that net's going to appear? What advice could you give them?
So especially like, I mean, playing off of that quote, like when I, sometimes in life, you know, you have to make big leaps and big jumps. And for me, it was like, I just tried to put enough things into play that like seemed good. So I knew that like the rink I was going to was good. It had plenty of ice. People were friendly. I know that my coaches, you know, knew what they were talking about and had like worked with other athletes before. And then I knew that there was like a living situation and like things like that. So I just, you know, set yourself up for success, but there is that one point where you just do have to let go. For example, I wouldn't like just quit skating today and just go out and start a business like today, because I have nothing in place where that would probably go well for me at all. Like, I'm not saying I wouldn't figure it out, but you know, I would set things up so that there would be like stuff like that. So, but there's just that one point where, so I guess for me, it was living without regrets. Like, why I went back to skating, because I decided that I wanted to try to come back to skating, because if I didn't, I felt like I would regret it forever. If I just went into coaching and I just went into college and then whatever else I chose to do with my life, because this has been such like a fundamental part of me, not just like what I do, but like who I am as a person for so long, that I would just be over, like more unhappy if I didn't go for it than if I did and it didn't work out. Because then I could really say, you know, I'm retired with skating because, you know, I went for it and, you know, I just wasn't at the same level, like world class, but I put everything into it and that was that. Because I feel like you can always go back to average, but there aren't that many opportunities in life to do something absolutely incredible.
Wow. That's powerful. You can always go back to average. So you know what? It's funny. It reminds me of a quote that I saw. I think it usually comes out like just before the new year when everybody's thinking about like weight loss and getting healthy, but they're like, you know, we guarantee you that we'll give you your weight back if you quit, right?
Yeah, like
back to being fat, no problem.
Yeah, like you can always, you know, you can always go back to like what you were doing. Yeah. Or, you know, if someone's working a 9-to-5, but they have this like business idea and like they put some things in play, but they're on the fence. Like I would always say, because that's how I live my life, is go for it. Yeah. Absolutely go for it, because I'm sure somewhere you could go back to having a 9-to-5 office job. It may not be that exact job, but I'm sure that then you could find something like that. So, you know, I knew I could always go back to teaching skating and I can always go back to school, but the window for being like a world-class ice skater again was going to close sooner rather than later. So yeah, that's kind of my line, is you can always go back to being like average, normal, neurotypical, but very few opportunities in your whole life to do something extraordinary. So I would always say take it, because life is relatively short.
So true. So true. No, I love it. You know what, Gracie, it's one of these things that even when, you know, you're talking to investors, or, you know, if you watch the Shark Tank, investors don't want to invest in somebody that's not all in, right? So, you know, you may be working on a project, you know, it may be a part-time thing for you, but there's something magical that happens when you actually jump, when you actually make the leap and you jump in faith and you say, you know what? I don't know what's going to happen. I don't understand it. I don't have all the details figured out yet, but I'm going to jump. I'm going to go for this. And it's amazing what happens.
Yeah. And doing, and like you said, things with passion, like a lot of people have side projects. You know, if you have a regular job and you're doing a side project, but you can tell the people that like that's where their passion lies, or they're just doing something part-time. So like for me, like I love to bake. It's one of my favorite activities is baking. And so I've had people before like, oh my God, you like, why don't you open a bakery? Like, you know, you could sell these, but like my passion, I don't have enough passion and like want for it to do it. Like, it's not like I wouldn't, oh yeah, that'd be fun. But, oh yeah, that'd be great. You know, you call it whatever, but you can just tell like when I talk about it, it doesn't have the same passion as like, or, and I don't feel it when I talk about something else. Mm. And like, that's what makes like certain, it's always great to see someone, like it's always magical when people talk about the things that they love, because you can see it and feel it. And like, you know that they're committed to it. They love it. And it's something that's like inside of them. It's not fabricated. It's not some sort of show. It's like that's everything that they love, which is like, what's more human than that?
Oh, totally. You know, and I think that's what actually attracts people to each other that are kind of on a different, I always say it's kind of a different frequency, right? So, you know, if you're trying to like tune into a certain radio station, you know, or XM radio or something like that, you got to be tuned into that perfect number in order to receive the actual, you know, sound, right? And so I think in life, one of the things that really attracts people who are performing at a higher level is that we're just on a different energy. We're just, you know, we're going for it. And that's all we think about. And we're all in. And so everything around us, I know with me in business, you know, some people, I guess, maybe I drive them crazy. But when you follow me, even if you follow me on social media, you know, I'm such a big thinker and I'm such a big dreamer and I'm going for it. And you know what? The reality, Gracie, is we're down here right now. We're on Earth. We have one chance at this deal, right? There is no dress rehearsal. This is life. And why not go out and get every single thing that we can possibly get out of it? Why not?
Yeah, like, absolutely. Like, that's really, yeah. And like, if people like, yeah, like at the, I definitely understand. I relate to like the frequency analogy, because that's just why like you just like click with some people. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not just that you have common interests, but it's the way that you feel about the common interests and communicates and, you know, relate to certain things, like that makes like connection unique. And yeah, like, so something like that's how I felt about coming back to competitive skating, is I felt like I was still on that frequency of being like an elite athlete and like a world-class figure skater. And I wasn't ready, you know, I wanted to just see if I was again. I wasn't ready to like, you know, you can always be average. You can always go back to being normal, but like, you know.
I love that. Well, you know what, Gracie, you are world class, and I really want to thank you, you know, for being brave, being strong, coming out today, and you know, just sharing your story with us. I know that there's going to be somebody that's going to listen to this, that's going to watch this, and you're going to really impact their life. And you've got a huge fan here. All right. I'm cheering you on. I know Abby's cheering you on. Our entire family's behind you and with you. And just keep going for it, because every time I think of Gracie Gold now, I have a totally different, you know, interpretation of who that is. You've got such a huge personality, and you're just such a real, you know, real and transparent and just such an awesome, awesome human being. So thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. Okay. All the best. Keep crushing it, and go Gracie, go.
Thank you. Bye guys.
Wasn't that awesome, guys? Thank you so much, Gracie, for sitting down with me and sharing with our NoBullBiz community. One of the things that I loved, which Gracie had pulled off the fridge there, was jump and the net will appear. And man, I love that quote. You know, I think in business, we need to do more of that. You know, we need to take big jumps. We need to take bigger leaps of faith.
And you need that. You need that as an entrepreneur, as a business owner, as you know, somebody like Gracie, who really at the end of the day, she is the founder of her professional sports brand, Gracie Gold, right? And so I can't even imagine what she's going through right now as she's daily training and she's on that course, she's on that track for Beijing. So Gracie, we wish you all the best. I know that we're gonna be doing some stuff together in the future, and Gracie's actually invited us down to where she's training in the US, and there's gonna be an opportunity, I know, in the near future, where we'll be down there on some other projects, and we'll do a follow-up to this, kind of a part two, if you will, with Gracie, and show you kind of behind the scenes and some of the training and some of the stuff that goes on with Team USA. So look forward to seeing that coming up in the future. So thanks again, Gracie, for being with us. Thank you guys for hanging out and being part of another awesome NoBullBiz feature. Until then, stay focused, take lots of action, and just have a lot of fun. All right, guys? Cheers.